Gavin.
Michael.
It's good to see you, even in this strange way, in these strange times.
Well, I'm aware of the fact that normally when I see you, I walk into your into the gallery, and because of a good barber next door, I always have my head done just to walk in so that we look like brothers.
You have just preempted the first thing I was going to say, because I was going to share with people the fact that you and I have one thing at least in common, and that is that we do both use Derek at Uppercut for our hairdresser.
And Derek actually has a wonderful chair that you sit in, which was actually made in Catania. And my son-in-law is Sicilian.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Do you think when this is all over, we should ask Derek whether he could do a different style for us in terms of hairdressing?
You mean some Elton John transplants?
Well, I don't know. And I'm not sure about a transplant, but...
I once asked him if he could do a Kevin Keegan perm for me. He said it wasn't enough to grab hold of, I'm afraid.
Do you think this is the only style he does?
Oh, no, I've sat in there and watched him do some quite intricate things with local councillors.
I would love to do some intricate things. Local. Gavin, you were. Can we talk a little about your childhood?
Sure, if you like.
You were born in Yorkshire.
Yeah, in Goole.
In Goole, a hell of a long time ago.
Yep.
1943,
yeah.
What was your childhood? Tell me what your childhood was like.
I had a very happy childhood. It was quite blissful. I had a younger brother and I had three older siblings who were quite a bit older than me. There was about 8 years gap between me and the next one up. So I was a little bit of a mistake, and my younger brother was a year or a year and a half out. So I was having a buddy, you see. So. It was a very happy childhood. The only thing that the dark cloud on it was that my dad died when I was 9, so that colored a lot. But I enjoyed Goole. Goole was a sleepy place. Nothing happened. It was entirely self-contained. Nobody came into Goole unless you were going there. And it was a happy time for me.
Was there music in the family?
My mother's an amateur cellist. She would practice most days. My dad was an amateur bass baritone singer, sang in the choir and sang in the local amateur operatic societies. My uncle was a church organist. Another aunt was a sort of semi-professional concert pianist. So most of the family, different sides of the family, sang in the church choir. So there's a lot of music all the time.
And what was the first music that you had? I mean, were you taught an instrument when you were little?
My mother started to teach me the piano when I was about 5. Then within a year, she realized she'd probably done as much as she could. So I went to a lady called Miss Chambers across the back lane, a very formidable lady, very large, used to sit alongside with her legs wide apart and a skirt hoisted up, which was quite intimidating for a 7-year-old.
That's wonderful. And how long did she teach you for?
Oh, well, I was with her probably till I was about sort of 14 or 15. Then I was taught by the music master at the grammar school, Dr. Ramsey, Cyril Ramsey, who was a great pianist himself, a composer, a very good teacher. And eventually we became quite close because ultimately when I did A-level music, I was the only person doing it. So it's one-to-one conversations between the two of us for a couple of years, which is great.
But you didn't go on to uni to read music?
Well, I had no idea.
Did you? How did that work?
Well, I had no idea I was actually going to do music at all. I started the sixth form where you have to do your A-levels, and I was doing 4 A-levels, general studies, English literature, French, and geography. And by the Christmas, I got in geography no marks for any piece of work at all. So the geography master said, "Bryars, it's a waste of time you doing this, you know." So he took me to the headmaster and said, "Bryars is going to have to drop geography." So he said, "That's all right." So I thought, "Great, only 3 subjects." He says, "But you're not going to get away with that. You'd have to take another subject." So I said, "Okay, I suppose I'll do music, sir." So that's how I started in music, by mistake.
But the main subjects at university?
Well, at university, in the first year at Sheffield at that time, you did a general arts first year, and then you specialised from your second year onwards. So at Sheffield, I took up philosophy. I had the English literature, French, and music. So I did those four. And then when it came to choose at the end of the first year, it turned out that you could only do music with a modern language as a dual honours. So I didn't want to do that. So I did philosophy instead and carried on playing music, which by then I was starting to be a bass player and playing jazz. And by the middle of my second year, I was working professionally as a bass player and made very few lectures before midday.
How did that happen? I mean, how did you find the double bass?
Well, I always wanted to play the bass. Even when I would listen to pop songs, I'd follow the bass line. I never knew the words or the tunes. And with jazz, I'd always follow the bass lines and the implied harmonies and the way people would construct a bass line. So I'd always loved it, but there was no bass in Ghoul. That's it. My mother played the cello, but there's no double bass. So I didn't actually see one close up until I went to university. And there was one in the music department lying in the corner of the basement, which was rather sort of messed up. The strings were slack. It was cracked and so on. So I asked the professor if I could maybe fix it up and if I could try it out. And he said, of course. So I fixed it up, got new strings and so on, taught myself to play. And as I was talking to Jay a few minutes ago, who was himself taking up the double bass, I pointed out, within 5 or 6 weeks, anybody who plays a bass knows they can hold down a professional job. It's not hard.
And do you know why you were attracted so early on to the bass line and things?
Well, I think
it's quite unusual, isn't it, for someone to listen to that?
Maybe. Well, I suppose because having a mother as a cellist, she was generally taking the lower part in ensembles. And I was aware of the kind of the fundamental importance of the double bass, of the bass register anyway, in terms of generating the energy for the whole orchestra or ensemble, or whatever. And you find in those moments where the basses drop out, you feel there's something missing in your life. Because the energy is not there, and it's not generating the power and generating the upper harmonics that it would do when it's there. So it has, although it's not a particularly attractive instrument from the first sight, it does have this incredible power and this importance.
Takes a bit of carrying around.
Well, that's another question. Of course, eventually my son plays a bass, so I carry two basses.
Right. What, one under either arm?
Well, depends. But also, but my two eldest daughters, they took out the cello, so at a time when I was carrying a bass and two cellos in the back of the car. You know, it's ridiculous. You know, people joke about, why didn't you take up the flute or all that kind of thing? And it's such a wimpish instrument, I wouldn't touch it. But I remember the writer Miles Kington used to have a regular column in The Independent some years ago. And he was saying how he was a bass player himself. I think he played some traditional jazz. And he was saying how he'd never seen an adequate answer to the thing that bass players always get yelled at. They always say, oh, he's crying. Why is he crying? Can you get it under your chin? So how do you get that under your chin? And so he says, by keeping my bloody big mouth shut. But that invites aggression, so you've got to be very careful.
And then you actually, you did art. You were at Leicester.
Well, later I started to teach art, but that's a sort of roundabout story, because by then...
Tell us how that happened then.
Well, when I left university, I just carried on playing jazz. So I was a jazz musician for a few years. Then I started to sort of try composing. Eventually met John Cage and worked with him in America. And at the end of the 60s, I came back and started being part of the sort of this new music scene, the experimental music scene in England, principally in London. And at that time, musicians like myself and others were not employable in university music departments or conservatoires. We were too dangerous, too irresponsible, and so on. We were outside the establishment and beyond the pale, etc. So there were no kind of commissions, no kind of invitations to play or to write things for other orchestras or whatever. So the one place where you could get employment was in the art colleges.
Right.
At that time, the art colleges, the late 60s, early 70s, there was a kind of a liberal outlook. They were interested in art in a wide sense. And there were some art colleges which employed musicians within the art department. And I was lucky that I did that first in Portsmouth, then at Leicester, where I found myself in the company of fine artists rather than musicians. And I always said that when you're in that situation, you find you talk about ideas and art. If musicians are together, just moan about who's getting the work and who's got the most money. But there was a sort of a level of intelligent conversation and conceptual conversation with the fine art people I didn't get anywhere else.
Yes. And how long did that last for?
Well, from... Well, I was in Portsmouth for a year and a half, from 69 to 70. And then Leicester, I was there. I taught in Leicester for about 24 years, but I was in the fine art department for about 8 years, because during that time, we were asked to create a new degree. And I wrote a proposal for a degree in performing arts, which included music, which I then ran. But for 8 years, I was in the fine art department.
Right. And love of art has stayed.
Absolutely. Even when I was at university, my girlfriends were always from the art college because they were the best dancers and knew the best bars.
That's wonderful. And 1969, yesterday we played your piece that you wrote very early on, I suppose, The Sinking of the Titanic. And you were kind enough to play that for us in the gallery. A little while back. Will you tell us a little bit about how that came about?
Well, that was a piece in 69. I'd come back from America and I was working in Portsmouth with the fine art department. And I was doing kind of musical things with students. We were doing things which were sort of like post-Fluxus. We're doing Cage pieces, Lamont Young, all kinds of things. Experimental things. And there were some students who were working outside the normal boundaries of printmaking, sculpture, painting, and so on, who were being given a bit of a hard time by some of the more traditional members of staff. And a lot of the time they would say, well, what you're doing, it's not really proper artwork, is it? And so on. So some of the students put together an exhibition of their work to show what they did and asked any of those staff who supported them if they could include something. So I included this little one-page sketch on about the sinking of the Titanic, the idea of a piece of music that originates in the event of the Titanic sinking, especially focusing on the behavior of the musicians as the ship went down. And so that was a kind of germ of the idea. So, and it was also at the time when conceptual art was very big. You've had things like When Attitude Becomes Form at the ICA, and people like, Art Language, Joseph Kosuth, those people were, Keith Arnott, those people were producing things in exhibitions. So the idea of doing a printed page on a wall was actually seen as an aspect of visual art. So that's where that piece started.
And you've played it all over the place, haven't you?
Yeah. As I said, I did this first thing in 1969. And I thought of it as being like the idea, the equivalent of a conceptual artwork, a conceptual piece of music. And in the sense that if you were to read through these notes and use your imagination, that you would create the performance in your own head. So it was like a kind of way of stimulating mental and imaginative activity. And I remember, a couple of years later, there was a guy, Victor Schoenfield, who ran a kind of music promotion thing in London, decided to give me a whole evening of my work in 1972 at the Queen Elizabeth Hall and asked if I would perform this piece, and said, it's all very well you talking like that, but what would it sound like if everybody else could hear it? So I was challenged, you see, and then I created the actual piece of music, which takes the form roughly of what we saw in the gallery performance. It's varied enormously in terms of its content, because as things go on, it was an open piece. If I find out something new about the Titanic, I would introduce it. Physical elements, social elements. I interviewed survivors, all kinds of things. So it became like a kind of detective story. It was sort of like a forensic exercise. And from all the evidence, I put together what seems to be likely as performance data. And so the center of the piece is the hymn, which I'm pretty sure is what the band played as the ship went under. And that was, the report came from one of the wireless operators who was in the water about 150 feet away from the ship as it went down. And he said the band was still playing. They were playing this hymn called Autumn. And he said, however they did it, I can't imagine. So that becomes the starting point of the piece. And then after that, it develops into all sorts of treatment and different kind of approaches.
When you played it for us in the Goldmark front room to an audience of 60 with just a small ensemble, I cannot tell you how moving I found it. It was just extraordinary.
Well, I love doing that version because a lot of the versions I've done have been with quite large numbers of people. I mean, maybe a dozen or upwards. And I have I had a touring ensemble version that I did in 2012, the centenary of the Titanic sinking, which included all four of my children as well as my ensemble. And that was the sort of average size of the piece. But I know, having played, 4 or 5 years earlier in the gallery, when we did a concert, that you can really only accommodate sort of five or maximum six people on that stage, and certainly not a keyboard. So I was aware of the limits, and also I was aware of the kind of possible duration of the piece. So I made this scaled down version, which contains everything that's in the music. It's in a concentrated way. So it's not a kind of a watered down version, watered down is a bad image for the Titanic. It's not sort of diluted. There I go again. It's not reduced in any sense, so it is the essential piece. And at the same time, we decided I'd do the same thing with Jesus Blood Never Failed Me Yet, which had also generally been longer. So I did these two sort of Titanic about half an hour, Jesus Blood about 25 minutes, which are the oldest pieces I kept in my catalogue. And they date from that art school period, 69 when I was at Portsmouth, 71 with Jesus Blood when I was at Leicester. So they come from an art environment. So I thought doing it in your art environment was a really nice kind of completes the circle.
Will you tell us a bit about Jesus Blood as well? Because that, again, was incredibly moving.
Well, that piece came about when I was teaching at Leicester, but I'd also been involved in some sort of so-called underground film work in the 60s and early 70s, work that I don't really think very highly of now. But a friend who was helped produce a lot of that work was making a film about people living rough in London. And he made the film, and I wasn't involved in making the film, but I'd give him some help with some audio tapes and so on. And so he simply gave me all the audio tapes that he no longer needed, because he knew that a big reel of tape was worth something to us, because we didn't have a lot of money. And so I had these, and I would normally have just erased them and started work on them or whatever. But for some reason, I still to this day can't think why, I listened all the way through to one of them. It was a big reel of tape, which lasts about 30 minutes. And on there, you heard people, these old men, these people living rough, mostly alcoholic, talking about their lives, maybe breaking into song. It was very sad stuff. Then, but right in the middle, somewhere, there was this moment where for 26 seconds, this man sang this fragment. And it was so striking because it was so fresh. It was so musical. And there was an honesty and a lightness in it. And I was just, what on earth is this? But that's all there was. So I listened to it, and I could hear that the ending could naturally go back to the beginning. So at that time, we were doing a lot of things with tape loops. So I made a loop out of it, and it turned out to be in tune with my piano. It's in A major. So I was able to sketch out a rough accompaniment. And then one thing led to another. Eventually, I had to make the tape, the loop, into a secure full reel. And I took that to Leicester, where I was teaching, where there was a sound studio, to copy the tape and so on. And then I decided to add a kind of underlying accompaniment, just support the man's voice and sort of take it on a kind of strange subliminal journey. And I realized the power of the man's voice in itself when at Leicester I was copying the tape, because I set the loop going on one tape and it was transferring to another one, and it was going to take about 30 minutes or so. So I got it going, made sure it's okay for about 5-10 minutes. And then the studio's on the 9th floor, this Fletcher building, and I went downstairs to get a cup of coffee and came back up, and the tape was still going, but the environment had become very subdued. What would normally be quite a lively space was very subdued. Somebody was sobbing in one corner, and I thought, what's happened? And then I just heard this voice drifting through, and I realized this old man's voice in itself had this power of taking over the space and creating a kind of tone in itself without me doing anything. So I became aware that whatever I did in terms of accompanying, adding instrumentation, adding harmonies and so on, I had to always respect that the center of the piece is the old man's voice. And I was basically putting it in different moving environments, rather like, you know, somebody finds a very beautiful diamond or something and you put it into a ring. The setting can either ruin it or enhance it. And that was the key to the piece.
Yeah, it was extraordinary. Absolutely. And again, the effect, I think we're going to play it after this. Mm-hmm. And the effect that you had on people when you played that in the gallery was quite amazing. Very, very special.
Well, I enjoy playing in your gallery. unfortunately, we can't do that at the moment, but it's a great place. I mean, I enjoy coming into your gallery anyway, because you're about 10 miles away from me, and I pop in and have a cup of coffee, we chat. Because I write with pencil and paper, I need to have the manuscript scanned to send them to my my editors to put into the computer. And Max, just around the corner, will scan on your A3 scanner, and he has it automatically sends them off to my people. You're part of my production line.
We will send the we'll send the fee sometime in the future. I'll have a look at that.
I think when my will is published, you might be some things you might want to contest and claim a percentage of something.
Tell me, but you have worked with some extraordinary people all over the world. Will you tell me a little bit about working with Brian Eno?
Well, Brian Eno, he came from the same art school background. When I was teaching at Portsmouth, he was a painting student at Winchester. I think he also studied with Roy Ascot as well, so he's part of that era of art education. And I knew him at that time, and he used to come to concerts that I gave at the South Bank. And we became friends, and he initially, one of the jobs he was doing was for Ian Tyson, next door to Tom Phillips in Camberwell. He was working as an assistant printer, and they were printing some of my scores. So we were in touch with each other. Then he moved into the rock world and achieved, you know, a degree of success and fame. And then we started this record series, Obscure Records. And we worked together on that. He was the producer. He was the main man because he was in the insides of the record industry and so on. And I would advise him about possible materials, and so would Michael Nyman. And he decided the first album on his series would be those two pieces, Jesus Blood Never Failed Me Yet and The Sinking of the Titanic. So that was Obscure One, and it achieved a kind of cult success. I mean, the record label was called Obscure with good reason, because it's very hard to find distribution. At one time, at that time, I was doing a lot of kind of academic research, and I loved this thing of having to look for something. Like, you were looking for some writer or something, and an artist, and you're checking the index at the back of the book, and eventually you don't see it. Eventually you find it. Great. That feeling of discovery was great. So that was part of the marketing strategy of Obscure Records, which meant that very few people got it. That it was eventually available, but they'd gone by post, and eventually some got into record stores, but not many. But there are quite a lot of people for whom that particular album was significant. They became, you know, really their favorite records. And eventually I did a later version with Tom Waits, and Tom told me, he'd got in touch with me in the 80s because he'd lost his recording, the original recording, and he said it was his favorite record. And I thought, well, that's very, very high praise, you know.
That's amazing. And you've done all sorts of, I've rarely come across anybody as active as you are. You see him every time I see you. You are, I mean, not now, of course, but just about to fly off to do something somewhere. And whether it's a ballet that you've just done or a new opera or constant, yeah. It's extraordinary.
Well, you always say when I'm chatting to you, you're exhausted by the time I leave.
Well, that's not difficult.
Well, that's true.
No, the energy. Is absolutely amazing.
Well, I, you know, while I can still do it, I do. But I do enjoy performing and be involved with live performance, because it's too easy for a composer to sit in a room like this and just quietly get on, and you send the music to the publisher and they send it out to the performers, then people do it and it's performed, and then you might be invited to the premiere or whatever. But I have my own ensemble as well, so I actually play, and so that people can actually see that this is the person who wrote this, and I'm engaged with the audience, not just with the performers, and not just my publisher. I'm part of that whole social framework, which is what constitutes performance of a piece of music. And it's important to me. You know, I've recently been touring with the dance company from Angers, the dance that ballet that I did for Merce Cunningham. We toured for about a year and a half, and able to play it in places like Portland, Oregon, in Davis, California, in Abu Dhabi, and most of France. And just that thing of people are seeing this for the first time. And it's great to be in a situation where they're acknowledging the quality of something, even though it's quite an old piece that dates from 1999. But for them, it's the first time. It's rather like when I used to perform one time, and my managers were, I had managers those times, they would put together programs and they would put in pieces like Sinking of the Titanic and Jesus Blood. And I would say, oh, do we have to do with those again? And they say, well, look, you've done it a lot of times. If you're playing somewhere in Australia, they've never heard it. And so just think of the Rolling Stones playing Satisfaction. You know, they've got to play it every night because, you know, somewhere in the back of behind, they've never heard them do it. And what you do, you then find value in it and you realize, actually, this is pretty good stuff. And I, even now, in spite of having heard Jesus Blood, that old man's voice repeat so many times, it still touches me every time, every time.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's fantastic. I wanted to ask you something. You've been very sweet in terms of your support for my daughter Freya, who is a violinist, and apart from writing a piece for her, which is yet to be, oh, great name that you chose. Goldmark Variations, yes. And when you come to, you're good enough to come to her festival that she has in Stamford.
Yeah.
Despite the fact that she periodically plays Brahms, and I know that you're a not necessarily the greatest lover of Brahms.
I hate him pathologically.
Can you? I mean, that may well surprise people. Can you tell us why? Because I know you're dead serious about that.
Oh, I am. I just find Brahms unbelievably tedious and very heavy, overblown, far too dense, quite unsubtle. A friend of mine, John White, he refers to Brahms saying there's a sound in Brahms, which is, he calls the development noise, which normally happens in the development section of a symphony system, but that's there in every minute of Brahms. It's just too fussy and overwritten. I'm not alone. Britain hated Brahms. I've been told that he used to play, one day a year, he'd play the music of Brahms just to remind himself what a rotten composer Brahms is. You know. So yes, Freya has put in Brahms in her concerts, and I will go. And out of loyalty, not just out of loyalty to her and her friends, but because I want to hear some great playing, and I will hear that in spite of the music. It happened to me once also when Martin Cropper, who teaches violin, head of strings at Oakham School, where my son and daughter were, he had an evening of both Brahms sextets. His father, Peter Cropper, was a great violinist, and I went along, and it was, the first one was in the first half, the second one in the second half. When I went, Martin saw me, and he said, what are you doing here? He couldn't believe that I would go to a concert which is entirely Brahms, at least with Freya. She does put some other stuff in, bless her. But this is entirely Brahms. And I said, look, it's loyalty. It's family loyalty. I want to hear you people. You're my friends. I want to hear you play. And, you know, there's a lot of music is down to friendship and connections and being on the same side of someone. It's unfortunate that some of them have this sort of aberration whereby they like Brahms, but everyone has a weakness, and you just have to acknowledge that.
And if I were to ask you who you did admire, the big influences?
I can't think of any real influences. I mean, Cage, of course, was someone I admired and worked with. But the great thing about Cage is that nobody who works with him or studies with him ever ends up sounding like him. That's a measure of his greatness, the fact that he allows you to go away and be yourself. With many other teachers, they insist on you towing a kind of party line. He never did that. But a lot of composers who I admire, and not always obvious ones, Carla Bley, the jazz composer, is one of my big favorites and a good friend. I love her work. I know Arvo Pärt is a friend. I like a lot of Arvo's work, but not all of it. I think sometimes it just goes too far. I remember tenor John Potter saying once, you know, we were sitting at one point in a rehearsal of an Arvo Pärt piece in Marseille, and he turned to me and says, you know, Arvo just won't leave any words out. It's in the Bible. He has to set all those words. He can't just edit it down a bit. It's just too much. But a great composer. I mean, I tend to listen more to earlier composers like Richard Strauss, but also maybe Schubert, Renaissance composers too, like Gesualdo, and some jazz. I still listen to some jazz.
I want to read you a list of names. And they are Duchamp and Man Ray and Ionesco and Umberto Eco, and to add to that, Gavin Bryars.
Great man, all of them.
Tell us, because that's extraordinary.
Well,
absolutely extraordinary.
The thing we have in common, as you well know, is that we are all transcendent satraps of the College of Pataphysics. That is what links us. I didn't know Duchamp. I nearly met him once in 1968. But that's not important in this context. The thing is that within the College of Pataphysics, which started about 1949 or so in France, there are various kind of levels of activity within the college, different hierarchies, different subject matters which people pursue and study and manifest. But there is this level where you're deemed to be at such a level that whatever you do is supreme. And whatever you do, you only have to do what you do in order to demonstrate that you are at this transcendental level. And it's awarded mysteriously, usually through the head of the college, and sometimes with reference to other people. But the people who are elected to that are people of really the highest quality, and not very obvious people too, very diverse. And it's not like really like being offered a knighthood where you can turn it down. You're told you are one. And that's it. This happened to me about 3 years ago. I joined the college, became involved with the college in the early 70s, when I was doing a lot of work at Leicester in the art college, teaching Duchamp and studying Duchamp. And I got in touch with the college to ask some questions. And eventually I found that I joined the college. And then a bit later, I became a regent of one of the musical areas of the college. And then, about 3 years ago, I was made a satrap. So, yeah, I'm in that company, and it's a strange bunch, and that's a loose connection between us, and there are many others too.
And as a regent, did you have to contribute? Did you have to work?
Yeah, as a regent, I was involved with this area of music, and so I would write music, the music I write, but they would see some of the music as I write as actually already having pataphysical qualities. I did a performance in France in 1979, where some of the pieces there were distinctly linked to the College of Pataphysics and to particular pataphysicians. And then there were some pieces I made which were entirely based on the concept of pataphysics. I've done also some recordings. There's a recording which will come out in a year or so within the college of a piece taken from a section of Jarry's Dr. Faustrol, pataphysician, which I've set to music with for two French voices who were members of the college themselves. So as a regent, that I was involved in musical activity and also in general activity within the college. It was as a satrap, because I still do that, but I'm not obliged to do anything, although of course I do.
And do you have that for life now?
Oh, and beyond.
That position.
And beyond.
And beyond.
Of course.
I wouldn't argue with that.
Well, and the thing about pataphysics, it's rather like Zen Buddhism, that people say, how do you become a Zen Buddhist or a pataphysician? And the answer within both things would be, well, you already are that. You're just simply not aware of it. You know, the people are not aware of their Zen nature, and that's the essence of Zen. In the same way, there are people who precede the existence of pataphysics who would be deemed pataphysicians, or as they're often called, patacessors, because they are predecessors of pataphysics, people like Jules Verne, for example. So there's a lot of, it's quite quite an open thing in many ways. It's just a question of awareness.
That's wonderful.
No, it's not.
I've enjoyed it.
Wow.
Gavin, it's been great chatting. The time has gone very quickly. And let's hope next time we can meet in the barbers.
Well, I'd be after the barbers, because I'm not going to drink your coffee in the barbers, Mike. Come on, I don't get little bits of whiskers. And you know, you've managed to keep your head going because Fiona has got those clippers on your head. But I refuse to do that. My point about going to barbers is you have the chat with the barber. You don't do that if your wife does it.
Quite right. Quite right.
But give Fiona my love anyway.
I will. And I'll see you soon, Gavin.
Hope so, Mike.
Many thanks.
Take care.
If you've ever come and spent some time reflecting and ruminating in the toilet upstairs at the Goldmark Gallery, you might have seen these fantastic posters that show the number of incredible concerts that we've hosted here over the years in the Goldmark front room. Today, we're lucky enough that we're going to be showing one of our recordings of a fantastic concert that we had with Gavin Bryars' ensemble. You can catch him up here on the top left. Bryars and his crew are going to be playing Jesus Blood Never Fell Me Yet, one of his most important pieces of music, and The Sinking of the Titanic, two significant pieces in his career and in the history of music this century. I hope you enjoy them. Additionally, on Monday, during Mike's Monday lift, he's going to be talking specifically with Gavin Bryars. We're going to have a lovely interview with him. So if you have any questions for him about the history of music, about his career as a composer, then let us know and we'll make sure those get answered for you.
Thank you. Educate and train our customers.
Okay, so now we're going to look at some other of his prints.
I'm thinking very seriously about stopping making pots.
There's nothing forced. And I think his jugs are really the epitome of that.
Hello, welcome to today's broadcast from the Goldmark Gallery.
One of my most regular places to visit up in the Mark Gallery.